Well, I was born in Massachusetts, Newton, Massachusetts, which is in suburban Boston area. And by the time World War II came along, I had been moved with the family out to the Los Angeles area.
Where did you spend most of your childhood, though?
In Massachusetts.
What, as a kid running around in that area, was it a nice childhood? I mean, you look back on it, what did you do for fun in the summers, that kind of thing?
Yeah, I had absolutely an idyllic childhood. I came from a family with parents that were just world class, no question about it. And summers, we used to travel to places like the Cape or Cape Cod or up to Maine, and always family, you know, group stuff.
You know, just to get some sense of the kind of kids you were, you know, when you walk into a classroom, a bunch of kids in there, and there's always, there's a smart kid, the shy kid, the joker kid, yeah, the, you know, whatever. Right. If we walked into your classroom, which kid were you?
I was probably the smart kid. It seemed like when I was coming up through grammar school years, I was the boy that saved the reputation of the sex against the smart girls, you know. And I was a guy that always probably did everything the right way. I wasn't a heck raiser or anything like that.
Was there a sense of a love of learning kind of thing?
Probably to a minor degree, yeah. I wasn't obsessed with education or anything like that.
Yeah. It sounds like your parents had a big influence then on you.
Oh, definitely, yeah.
Did you have brothers and sisters then, too?
I had three sisters.
And what was the influence of having three sisters?
Well, the influence was that I've been accused by these three people of being the favorite, you know. And the joke of the family is that mother loved me best, but my dad and I were very close. And I can't remember ever being taught anything by my parents. It was just sort of absorbed, I think, because they were so good.
Living by example.
Exactly. Well, it's very interesting. We moved back and forth across the country a couple of times, and we had just resituated in Hermosa Beach, California, and my family had rented a house right on what is called the Strand, which is obviously the beach. And I remember hearing it on the radio, I think at our time, about 11 o'clock Pacific time as I remember it, but it was very exciting, and of course we imagined Japanese planes and submarines out in the water right outside of our front door, none of which was actually there. But.
Did it occur to you at some point that you could be called up and be pulled into this?
Oh, absolutely. Right then, and I think a lot of us, when we went, this was on a Sunday, of course, and when we went to school on Monday, I was still a senior in high school at that time. A lot of the guys were talking about, well, we got to go down and sign up, but I guess the glory of it sort of dwindled with time, and I decided to finish my education without plaguing my parents. I didn't become 18 until the following October, so probably my parents would never have given permission, I don't think, to, you know, to protect their precious little boy. That was kind of interesting too. When I turned to be 18, I went down to the aviation cadet program. That would be the Army Air Corps location in the city of San Francisco. My family had moved up to San Rafael by that time. In fact, the very day after I graduated from high school, they made the move up there. My dad had taken a job for a shipyard in Sausalito to go out across the country in Canada to solicit labor to come to the shipyard and so forth. That was his job during the war. Prior to that, it was totally different from what he had been doing. He had been a stocks and bonds guy, as I call it. But I went downtown to San Francisco to some location and asked if I could get to be in the program. And a little comical side here, when I walked into this room, I was I was about 6'4" or 6'5", I would presume, at that time, and the limit for being accepted into the aviation cadet program was 6'4" in height. So this little sergeant came up to me and he said, "Well, the first thing we got to do to you is measure you." So he took me over to the scales, and I've told this story many times, but he slapped the measurer down on top of my head and he says, "Now slump down." So they measured me at exactly 6'4", so I...
So an inch disappeared?
Yeah, I think an inch at least disappeared. And then I continued to grow, too, after that. But.
Why did you choose the Army Air Corps?
Well, that's a good question. I kind of blame it on my family because they probably wanted to see me in some training regimen that would last a little while so the exposure wouldn't be so bad. I don't remember having had a terrible yen to fly. I have a terrible interest in aviation now as a result of all this, but probably that wasn't the prime mover. That was exciting. I've written a little story of my war experience, and unfortunately a lot of that has to do with the training because it was so new to me. And when I took the test to be accepted, it was kind of interesting. There were a lot of general knowledge tests, but there was a lot of mechanical stuff that I was just not, you know, I was the schoolboy type of guy. And it was the English and the math that allowed me to pass with sort of a minimum grade in that test. But it was so interesting to go through the different kinds of courses that we went through over the year, let alone the flying part of it, but learning the, you know, aeronautics and weather and things like that that never had crossed my path in life before. And it was a really a wonderful experience, and of course the flying part of it too was just so exciting.
It must have been interesting to have all those guys from how was it with did everybody kind of mesh as far as you had all these guys, young kids coming in, and it's a big enterprise kind of thing. What was that like?
I would think that it was kind of a miracle that everybody was able to mesh fairly well. There were a few areas of conflict. I think some people had come from maybe areas of not too sound a background, not like my own, you know, with the family, solid family. And I think there was a tendency to toward conflict on a part of some of those people. But I think by and large, it was really outstanding the way they fit themselves together. There were some tough guys, there were some sissies like me, and we all just seemed to get along.
Do you remember when you got your wings?
Oh yeah, right.
What was that like?
I can't remember the ceremony, but I can just remember the pride, and they had us all set up for that because as we were approaching graduation, they had some tailors or something like this come to town and take our measurements. So we had an allowance of, I'm guessing, $250 to outfit ourselves with these pinks and green outfits and suntan outfits that we would wear as officers. And this was getting romantic. And then, of course, when you have your wings to wear and your lieutenant's bars to show that you are a real hero, it's pretty much of an ego trip.
What was your family's reaction at this point?
They're just out of sight. Yeah, they were proud as peacocks. And I did have a memory that sticks in our family. Of course, my parents are gone now, but the night that they took me to the train to send me off for the last time, you know, before going overseas, that was one of the tearful experiences. I think of what they were feeling and what they had to be feeling about what they were sending me off to.
I don't think people these days, particularly young people, know what the mood of the country was at that time. Do you remember what it felt like as a young citizen of the United States at that point?
Yeah, I remember that people, you know, the civilian people, had a great admiration, I think, and gratitude for the fellows that were going away. And you couldn't help but recognize that the country was really a unit, and people doing the war jobs and the family sacrificing with the shortages that we had, you know, like tires and gasoline and important silk stockings, important things like that. And they became treasured items that it was, and we all realized that it'll probably never be the same again. They just a whole country striving for one end, I guess.
Take me through when you finally joined up with a crew. How did that come about?
That occurred for me in Sioux City, Iowa, and where we went through a phase of training called OTU, Overseas Training Unit. And as a co-pilot, I wasn't really a red-hot pilot. I was selected to be a co-pilot as opposed to a first pilot. The first pilot had gone through some specific training as a crew leader, a phase of training that I didn't ever go through. He was the guy that taught me how to fly the B-17, and as opposed to another airplane. And these people were coming. There were nine of us. No, as a matter of fact, I think at that point we were still having 10-man crews. We had a bombardier, and we came from different phases of training, different geographical directions, and it was just 10 strangers, totally 10 strangers.
How is it you ended up in a B-17?
Because I made the choice. They gave us a little questionnaire, you know, what do you want to do the most in flying, and second place and third place. And third place was the heavy bomber for me. Second place was the B-25. Now, maybe that's not true. Do you know what a B-25 is? A two-engine bombing plane. I think maybe that was my first choice. And the second choice was transport. I think I probably had flying the hump, if you know what that means, in mind.
Over that the Himalayan mountains.
That sort of thing.
You know, I'm curious, a lot of guys...
So my last choice was the third, then they just ignored my first choice and sent me where I'd be willing to go, I guess.
A lot of guys that wanted to be pilots wanted to be fighter pilots. Did that ever occur to you?
Well, at my size, that was not a practical wish, yes. Very definitely, when I can remember the training phases when we were doing the acrobatics in the small training planes, that was exciting. Mm-hmm. And I can remember some of the little rudiments of having to do these maneuvers, spinning and snap rolls and slow rolls and things like that. It was very exciting.
Once you started training as a crew, you know, I should ask you this too. You were in the co-pilot seat. Was there some disappointment that you weren't first pilot, or?
I'm sure there was. Yeah. I didn't feel that I was exceedingly great pilot, and I didn't have the mechanical grasp of how this airplane worked. I think our first pilot, and of course our engineer who was trained for that, knew a lot more and would be able to help me respond to an emergency situation which required some knowledge of the operation of the airplane. Hmm.
Who was your pilot?
My pilot was a fellow by the name of Walt Monnett. He was a tough guy, sort of a fellow from Akron, Ohio. I was probably just 20 when we took off.
Okay.
I remember turning 20, or on my birthday, just before we took off from Lincoln, Nebraska.
So what was it like flying to, I guess, the UK?
Oh man, that was quite an experience, and it was kind of a long one too. First of all, we had become quite good friends, all 10 of us in this. Actually, we got reduced to 9 before we ever got out of there. They changed the program where they eliminated the bombardier and used one of the waist gunners as a toggleer, generally speaking, I think. But that's what happened to us, and so we were a 9-man crew and we took off. But we were all very good friends of each other. We missed the bombardier too. But the flight over was quite interesting. We got the brand new airplane that didn't have an hour on it, I guess, and flew it to Manchester, New Hampshire for one night, and then up to Goose Bay, Labrador, and we were snowed in up there for about 10 days. In other words, the snow had fallen so heavily they weren't going to let us out, and I suppose it was storming a lot too, but we finally took off on a horrible night, and as I recall, about 6 o'clock, and going out into darkness and nothing, and you're heading for Iceland. Went over the cap on Greenland, and I can remember seeing the gleam of the, by this time we had some moonlight, so the gleam of the white cap down there below. Not on the ocean, but the white cap of Greenland. And then it's dark all the way until almost dawn, we arrive in near Iceland, and I remember we had about, this was the first time I'd ever experienced this thing too, we had about a 50% cover, you know, cloud here and cloud there, so there was, but we didn't know that. It looked like a blanket out there, and when we came down to, you know, approach level under these little 50% clouds, well, there's this whole world, this island of Iceland, it's right there. I never even knew it was there. Of course, our navigator had a hope that it was there, but
how long did you spend on Iceland?
We arrived in the morning and tired, dead tired from having flown all night, and they sent us to bed about midday, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, and we spent almost 24 hours in bed, as I recall it, you know, catching up, and then off we went the next day.
Did you go over as a group, individually, or?
We flew individually. There was not formation or a group of airplanes. We didn't ever see anybody else. It was out there all by ourselves.
You know, you described the friendship, the crews,
yes,
and all
definitely.
That. Some were officers, some were enlisted. How GI was it in the aircraft, you know?
It was probably very un-GI. We always had the enlisted men come up and stand behind us, or if they needed to, you know, get in the seat and get the feel of what it was like to fly the airplane. And of course, by this time I knew how to fly it pretty well. Some of the operations I did quite well from the right seat, but we did have a very un-GI like relationship. I mean, for a 20-year-old kid and our tail gunners from some place, and God, he's my good friend. And, I'm supposed to be an officer, he's supposed to be an enlisted man, but that sort of a relationship really didn't exist.
Somewhere in that equation is everybody's life is dependent on the
yep,
other guy.
That's right.
I'm here and you describe a journey to Iceland and I'm thinking, everybody is thinking that navigator better know what he's
yeah,
doing.
Absolutely, yeah.
Well, take me through, where did you, when you took off from Iceland, what happened after that?
We flew to, as a checkpoint, Stornoway, Scotland, which is way up in the north, and then we flew down the, whatever sea is there, it becomes the Irish Sea, and we had a little icing problem along the way with some freezing up on the wings, which always is a matter of concern, but that was solved. And I remember so well that day of arrival, we went over, the weather was pretty good by the time we got down to the vicinity of Ireland, and we went over a corner of Ireland, which is just green like you can't believe, and with the hedgerows and the division of properties, it was just something like the likes of which I hadn't seen before in the U.S. And then when we made radio contact, the person that was giving us our landing instructions was a British lady. So first time I hear the British accent, and not coming from a man, God knows we should be guided by a man. And it was a woman. It was pretty interesting. But we also saw battleships down on the water, and then, you know, just a couple of ships widely separated from each other. But here was the first vision of war. You know, we've been going through all this theoretical stuff, and now here it is.
Do you remember kind of once you got sort of set, or you saw these ships and you were over there, was it a reality check? I mean, this was it, kind of.
I guess we didn't know what a reality check was in those days, but you know, a little doubt begins to set in, a little fear, and so forth.
How did you eventually get to your base?
They trained us. We landed in Wales, and they trained us to a place called Stone, England, and which was a big dispersal point for sending crews to different air bases. And, you know, I guess it's a matter of lottery, but I don't think we were there for a day or two or three, I'm not sure, not very long. And then they trucked us. In fact, they trucked 8 crews to the base where we flew from, Framlingham, the 390th Bomb Group, and 8 crews came into that base on the same day, which I didn't know then whether that was big or little or significant or not, but it seems now that that's very significant.
Had you been able to keep the plane you'd flown over with?
No, we left it in Wales.
So you got, what was the quality of the airplane you ended up with?
Well, I can't say that we ended up with an airplane. My own experiences were such that it wasn't bound to happen, that I was going to be on a single airplane all the time. But after we were there for a couple of weeks, I think probably, we had been out, during that period of time, we had been out on a couple of training missions over England in formation, you know, going, refreshing us on the same kind of stuff that we had done back in the United States. But when our first mission came, I, being the co-pilot, flew it with another crew. You remember that routine they used to go through? They put an experienced co-pilot with the green crew and saddle an experienced crew with a green group co-pilot. And so I didn't fly my first mission with my own crew. So I don't know what in the world airplane I had was in that day. And then the very next day we went on the second mission, and I did fly with my own crew, and I have no idea what airplane that was, because I was wounded on that mission, and I saw members of the crew after that, but they got shot down while I was coming, you know, recovering from my wounds, so they were gone.
Let me back up just a little. Do you remember, although you were with another crew, do you remember that first mission, what that was like?
Oh, boy. Yeah, it was a milk run, but what I remember the most is the feelings that you have when you're going down to the hard stand with the crew and after briefing and taxiing out. And I can remember it must have been 5 hours that we were out there on the perimeter track, nose to tail, working our way up to the takeoff spot. And that was kind of a memorable experience. And then finally you take off and everything's...
Most people, I think, really wonder what it must have been like to take off in one of those huge bombers fully laden with fuel and bombs.
Yeah, it becomes kind of a sloppy, unstable craft. And then when you get off of the ground, you're 30 seconds behind the guy ahead of you who's throwing out a bunch of prop wash, which makes the air unsteady, besides the natural tendency of the airplane to be wishy-washy. It seemed to me like a piece of art to get that baby up there.
And also to get all those planes coordinated.
Oh, how they ever figured that out. You've talked with Bill Pennebaker. Bill Pennebaker is a guy that I look up to, particularly in those days now also, but he had so much to do with explaining to us what we were doing and how that system worked. And I really admired that fellow.
Yeah. Did you feel like you'd gotten sufficient training as far as
Yes.
flying in close formation?
Well, you know, I can't really answer that question. Accurately, I would say yes, but that was one of my strong points. I was just sitting in the right seat, and I presume probably just by accident we got assigned to the left wing of the lead ship or the ship ahead of us. So. But I was awful good. That was one of the things that I was really good at, was flying that formation. And I really believe that perhaps that was taken into consideration with the position that another crew that I flew with, that we eventually got off the left wing of the lead ship of the squadron. And I am sure that I used to scare those guys in the lead ship when I would stick that wing in overlapping the wing. Coming home, you know, when we're fooling around as opposed to being scared to death on the way out.
What was the, and that maybe even the first mission, what was the mood on the ship when you were going out on that first mission?
Well, on that first mission I was with a strange crew, so I don't know. I'm just coming along for the ride, I suppose. The second one I can remember really well.
Well, let me ask, well, you know what, let me ask one last question about that first mission. Do you remember what you were feeling when you got back? That is to say, when there had to be some sort of aspect, like you'd prove something to yourself, you'd survive that first mission, you could do it, you know, that kind of thing.
I think the thought that I might have had was that now I know what a combat mission looks like. I didn't particularly feel that I was very heroic, because it was a really easy mission. We didn't have any opposition to speak of at all. And the things that I remember are the eeriness of, we were flying in some interesting looking weather, clouds on sides of us, I guess. And I remember that the lead ship used to drop flares where they dropped their bombs, and the rest of the ships would drop their bombs by toggle switch off of the lead ship. And there was this weird trails of smoke going down from these flares and with the wind currents and so forth that made sort of ripply appearing things, plus the clouds. It just seemed eerie to me, and I didn't know whether this was typical or not, but I guess ready for the next one, I guess. Mm-hmm.
Well, tell me about the second mission. What do you remember as far as that second mission?
Well, I was a dumb kid, but I knew enough when we were given the briefing that we were in for a bad day, because we were going to Merseburg, which was the oil target, and I guess it was either the number one target from the standpoint of the strength of the defense there, or the number two would probably be number two to Berlin. But everybody knew it was a horrible place to go from the prior missions to that location.
The Germans really protected those oil fields.
They surely did.
Yeah.
And as somebody has enlightened me in the subsequent years, as the lines were moving to the, you know, as the Germans retreated to the east, the guns came back, and there were more guns back, you know, concentrated to take care of the valuable targets. But
so everybody in the briefing room, what was the reaction?
When they pulled the curtain, you've heard the story about they pulled the curtain, and there's the yarn that goes from one, you know, from our base location in England on the map over to where the target was, and we were briefed for a tremendous amount of fighter resistance, and we were also told that we were going to have, I think it was like 1,250 fighters that we could expect, but we also had 1,200 B-51s, B-47s to escort us. We were given that kind of assurance, but everybody knew it was bad stuff, and it was.
Well, take us through the sort of chronologically the takeoff, the journey there, and what happened.
Well, I think the journey there was uneventful. As of course, I'm on number two mission. I don't know anything about what's normal or not, I suppose, but we were playful, I guess, on the intercom when we didn't have to be quiet, and we just went there uneventfully. It was, I guess, from the leadership standpoint, it became kind of complicated because they overshot where they were supposed to go and took us over an extra target worth of defense guns. But we never saw a fighter. And if the experience over the target was so horrible, the flak was just absolutely indescribably intense. And I'd never seen it before, but it couldn't have been any worse than what I observed that day.
You know, for people some people don't even know what flak is or, mm-hmm. or the effect. What's flak? What did it look like? What did you see?
I just saw where there was sky, all of a sudden a black burst all over the place. I have always maintained that the flak on that day was, they used to differentiate between tracking flak and barrage. It would seem to me it was a tracking barrage. They just burst all around us for quite a long, you know, it's many minutes.
What? So you come into the target, the flak's going off. What happened?
What happened to us was that we were off, flying off the right wing of a plane which was about the center of our squadron. And I didn't know exactly what happened, but I took my shot right as we were coming over the target. And apparently the guy that we were flying off of got a direct hit, and he went up in the air and exploded. And our pilot tried, who was fortunately flying the plane at that moment because I'd been shot, but I mean, I was useless. Our plane went up and away. And
had you dropped your bombs?
I don't think we had dropped our bombs, no. I'm not the guy to ask that. Yeah. The rest of them aren't around, so.
What happened as far as your this was flak? You were wounded by flak?
Right, yes. That was interesting, too. I don't remember hearing about shots quite like this before or after. A shot came through right in front of the pilot on the left side of the airplane, and it must have been a large piece of metal from the exploding shell. But it took off the top of our throttle handles, and I don't know whether you know what they look like or not. and it went right out next to my right shoulder and hit me, and sort of it hit me with such force, I think not only the shell part but the top of the throttle handles must have been involved too, but it just knocked me out. And I came through, I think I came to for a brief moment, and I recognized the outstanding thing about that was this noise. All of a sudden we got a hole in the front of the airplane and a hole over here, and a just roar of sound, you know, with the engines outside and the passage of air and so forth. But I was conscious for a few seconds, long enough to recognize that my oxygen mask was disconnected, and God knows how I ever discovered that, but I came to and plugged me in again and passed out again, and then came to a little later. I don't know how long, 15, 20 minutes, I don't know.
Where were you when you came to? I mean, you were on your way back?
We were on the way back. I think we dropped the bombs, just got rid of them someplace, which is sad too, but we were flying out in the middle of the sky with nobody around us anywhere, but there's a guy over there and a guy over there. They're all over, one by one. If the Germans had had their fighters up that day, they could have caused some terrible damage to us, but they were running out of gas and didn't have any gas to put them up with, I guess, this being in 1944, end of 1944. And this pilot, Walt Monnett, the only mission I flew with him, he was just amazing. He got us into a formation of single planes that had just sort of gathered together for protection more than anything else, and instead of wandering one by one home. And I don't know whether he was getting radio command from someplace, but it seemed to me that we suddenly were in a formation of maybe six airplanes, and he was flying the lead ship of a element, the low element of whatever was put together, and he had never flown a lead position before, so that was kind of good. But I was able to help him at least for a little while with my left hand. The right hand was no good, but I was working the throttles and he was working the steering wheel, and
yeah,
managed to stay in pretty good formation.
Were all the engines working?
Yes, all the engines. And somehow our engineer or somebody discovered that we had no hydraulics, that all of our lines, the fluid lines, had been shot out. So that gave us a problem at the other end of the trip.
And so you're flying back. You can still operate the throttles, even though they've been damaged, that kind of thing.
They're put together in such a way that you can work by the hand grasp from the left seat or the right hand from the left seat, you can work all four engines by the throttle. They just knocked off the tops, which were there for the purpose of using just the outside engines in case you had to use those, like in taxiing or something like that. But fortunately, we had the control of the four engines, and they were all operating.
How did you do as far as the journey back? I mean, you know, pain, fear, longevity.
Somewhere, somebody had given me a shot of morphine, I'm sure. This was something that was just routine in such a situation. And I can't say that I remember pain. My shoulder was right next to this hole, and stayed right next to this hole in the airplane where the shot went out of the airplane. And all of the blood, the bleeding that I was doing, just, you know, evaporated, I guess froze. And I didn't lose blood, I just was so lucky. My whole story is one of blind luck, I swear.
Was anyone else injured in the plane?
I don't believe so. I was under the impression that there was one guy that got a finger injury or something like that, but I haven't been able to track that tail down. But not that day.
How was the landing and coming in?
Okay, we were, of course, in this formation, which was made up of planes from different groups. I don't remember who they were or where they came from, but they didn't have the square J on the tail that we had. At least all of them didn't, I'm sure of that. But we all then were going to go to different places. But we had the problem of not being able to land on any normal base because we didn't have any brakes. The hydraulics had knocked out our braking power, so we Somehow or another, Walt got us to a base called Woodbridge. There's a place called Woodbridge not too far from Framlingham in England. And this was an RAF base with a 2 mile long runway just set up for emergencies like this one. And he landed the airplane and we couldn't get it to stop. You know, it just kept going and going. You cut your inboards, as I remember, to taxi. And so that was done, of course, immediately. And we got to the end of the runway. It's a big wide thing. It must have been a quarter mile wide, but we went around and around and around, and we still couldn't stop it. And so finally we just drove off the side of the runway into the grass, which was sodden and soft, and we just sank down. And this was a British base. Yeah. I had never had any contact directly with British people, so that was a fascinating experience for me.
What happened then after you finally came to a stop?
Well, we of course had to go through the routine of sending a flare-up wounded man on board, so they're going to send some medical attention out. So when the plane stopped in the grass, it was down quite a bit, and when you get out of the airplane, normally the pilot, co-pilot, the people in the front end of the airplane would come down through the nose hatch, which involves dropping down to the ground, but in this case it was just sort of like stepping down to the ground. And I guess I got myself out of there at a time when a British service ambulance was coming out from the infirmary on this base to get me. But I remember getting down, I think, by myself. I don't know how exactly I did that, but into the soft ground. And then I said goodbye to everybody because this ambulance came up and they immediately made me lie down and lift me in. And I thought I was ready to go. You know, I didn't feel any great pain. I was thoroughly conscious by this time.
So they took you, you're off to a hospital and?
They took me into the infirmary in this, I don't know whether it was a clinic or a hospital. I don't think you could grace it by the name of a hospital, but it was a kind of a empty looking place, I thought. Large rooms and not too much there. And they took me into they made me lie on a gurney when they took me out of the ambulance. They wouldn't let me walk at all. Much like would you go to a hospital today, when they wheeled me into this place and put me on a table. They cut my clothes off, which was all torn up and frozen to my body. And I remember thinking this was my expensive green shirt, and they were ruining my green shirt, you know. The other thing that I remember about that, they didn't do anything in the way of operation to me. They just they wouldn't give me anything to eat because they knew somebody was going to have to operate on me later. And they gave me a glass of hot water with rum in it, which was pretty good. I kind of thought that was kind of a nice experience. But pretty soon an American ambulance came for me and took me to the big American service hospital. I don't know, probably 20, 30 miles away and inland off the sea. And that was another experience, too.
What was that like?
Well, they were wheeling people in from ever. This mission had been a terrible, terrible mission. It was one of the worst that the group ever suffered. And, of course, all the groups had the same experience, and they were this wheeling guys in from, I don't know where they came from, but I was in a huge ward with all these other people, and all these beds were filled, and I don't know where they were going to put everybody that was getting wheeled in there, but each one of us had some needs, you know, medical needs. Mine wasn't severe, thank goodness, but I can remember people, or at least one guy, probably more, with his leg elevated, you know, some horrible injury to the leg, and I can remember oxygen tents and moaning and groaning, and I was getting a free ride compared to those people.
Mm. What do you remember about the medical treatment after that?
Yeah, I remember being taken into an operating room. Well, maybe after a couple, 3 hours, I suppose they were taking them one at a time as they could, and in accordance with the needs. I didn't need much, but they took me into this operating room and. I remember my first experience with sodium pantothol, which was known, I guess, as the truth serum. They could they use it in psychiatric treatment. They put you halfway out with the sodium pentothal, and you can then talk about those inner things, I guess. But with me, it was kind of funny because they gave me the full dose, and I remember just there was a horrible spinning motion like that. Lasted a second, maybe 2 seconds, and I'm gone. Just totally, that's the last thing I remember. And I woke up the next day in a ward, a large ward, nothing like the reception room that we had been brought into when we first got there. But I remember being waking up next to a colonel. Now I'm a measly second lieutenant, and that was pretty big time stuff.
He had been injured?
I don't remember. I don't think so. I think he was just in there for something else. But I had some horrible injuries in that war too. But I found out something about what happened to me and what they had to do to me in my arm wound. Apparently I had had some major vessel severed, and they had to go in there. They had to create another injury, you know, to sew this thing up for me, so that I ended up with the wound scar across here, and then there's another one under the arm. That's where they did their
work.
Magic work. And you look back on that and you wonder how in God's name those doctors and nurses could handle what they handled, guy after guy after guy, with emergency, different emergency after different emergency.
Huh, amazing. What happened to you after that? I mean, you had a period of recuperation. Did you ever fly after that,
or yep,
did you?
I went back to war, but I had some very, very interesting experiences too. I was in the hospital for a total of 30 days, and today we'd probably be out in a day and a half with what I had. They'd have you up walking. Well, of course I walked, but I had, you know, pretty grisly looking stuff under these bandages that were there, and they needed to heal. They created a pretty good injury when they went in under the arm. And of course, the other one was no finger injury either. But I remember being transported by way of an ambulance. Not that I needed an ambulance. It was a ride back to the airbase for Christmas. They sent me home. I was hurt on the 30th of November, so I was 3.5 weeks into healing, and they sent me back to the base for just to say hello, and I guess a Christmas party or something like that. But by the time I got back there, my crew had now gone on to 5 or 6 more missions, and they were hardened veterans. And I remember Walt introducing me around. He was so proud of me because I was off of his crew. It was quite an experience to go back there. And some of these people that I had known as clowns were all of a sudden decorated, you know, with DFCs, and just lots of changes made there before they got back. But then they sent me back the next morning. Oh God, one of the horrible experiences of the life of the war was the next morning. I was supposed to be at the infirmary by 9 o'clock. Well, somehow or another, I slept late, and I was waked up by the roar of B-17 engines. And they were taking off on the mission for the day. 9 o'clock's kind of late for a mission too. But I heard the roar of one's plane's engines, you know, and tremendous roar, and then cut off. And then roar again, and then cut off again, and then maybe another roar. And then it crashed at the end of the runway, right adjacent to this little village of Parham. And of course it exploded. And then a few minutes later it exploded again. Probably the gas went off, or ammunition or bombs or something like that. But everybody was, of course, killed, and miraculously nobody was injured in the town, as I recall the story, although there had to be some property damage.
This plane was taking off?
Yeah, and it was cold outside and probably kind of slippery out on the runway, and this one pilot got it all mixed up somehow or another. He cut through the trees and at the end of the runway and went into this village. That's a memorable experience too, and didn't even involve me.
Well, take me through your experience.
I went back to the hospital and then was discharged from the hospital on December the 30th. December 30th. The next day was New Year's Eve day, and it was a cold, cold night. and I had just arrived back. My bed was still where it had been when I went off on that second mission. And I was with my friends Walt and the navigator Eno Jarvie. And at 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning in darkness, they woke those guys up to send them off on this next mission. And when it was, we used to go to bed at night and with a full pot-bellied stove, you know, with a big glowing coal or coke fire, and about 2, 3 in the morning it would run out and we'd all freeze to death for the rest of the night. But when Walt left, he took all the blankets off of his bed and put them on top of me. And that was the last time I ever saw him.
That was, and you weren't on that mission because you were still physically recuperating.
Yep, DNIF, duty not involving flying, for another 10 days.
Do you know where that mission was?
That was to Hamburg.
Yeah.
You may have heard of that one before.
In Germany, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that particular mission, it was another pretty bad mission, but they got my guys.
Do you know what happened? They were shot down. Were they, did any of them survive?
Yes, then? 4 were killed, pilot, co-pilot, and I suppose the front end guys. And 5 guys survived and were POWs. And I have seen some of those people.
What, I mean, to the extent you want to talk about it, you had to have learned that plane was shot down. How do you deal with that?
I don't. This was New Year's Eve, big party coming up. I'd say about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, late in the afternoon, I was in the Nissen hut by myself. I don't know why I was by myself, but I was sitting there and some guy came in and got the personal items of these people. So then I knew that my crew had been involved and shot down. Huh. Took away the personal property of these 2 other guys.
Yeah.
And you don't know.
Was either at the time or when, you know, as you look back on it now, and you look at that huge piece of shrapnel that's coming through the airplane, it injures you, but, you know, it could have been worse, kind of thing. You were not on that mission that went down, that the co-pilot was killed. Is there any sense you have in looking back, a feeling of fate, or that somehow, you know?
Decidedly.
Or, yeah.
Decidedly. I don't know how I got picked for a role of luck. I mentioned 8 crews came on the base on the same day when we were distributed to Framlingham. My belief is that all 8 of those crews were shot, or in some way, not on the base anymore in full. There were a few scattered individuals like me. In other words, they were picking them off, you know, one by one by one. We weren't suffering heavy losses during those missions, but they were just dropping around me. Mm. And here I am.
I guess the question is, what happened to you after that?
I think it was about January the 17th when I was assigned to fly co-pilot on a mission to Cologne. However, the mission was aboard, and I remember I was so scared. I was so scared that I was just not a function. Well, that's not true. I was just scared.
And because you had seen what it was about at that point, right? No more kid adventure. This is,
yeah, I mean, war was no longer any fun. That second mission that I had seen was as bad as it, I'm sure it was as bad as it ever got. But anyway, that mission got scrubbed on the basis of weather. And then they had me sitting around there. I didn't have any crew to fly with. I don't know what happened to the poor crew that I was going to fly with that day, but if somebody told me that nobody wanted to fly with me because I was so scared, I'd have believed it. And I finally, they assigned me to a really interesting duty for a period of, I think, maybe as much as 2 weeks. It had to be in February, well, maybe in January, February. But they took a young fellow by the name of Joe Ford, who had just completed 35 missions as a first pilot, and me and an engineer, a crew of 3 people, and they sent us over to continental Europe, to a little burg called Merville, a little small French town. And they sent us out to advanced bases where B-17s had had to make emergency landings on the way back from missions. And we flew the airplane from there back to Merville and then went out to get another one and flew another one back. And that was really interesting. We had went to a different number of air bases and met people. We went to Brussels and we got out on the town and I could practice some of my high school French. But being billeted in this home for many nights, in this home of a nice older couple, and it was really interesting.
In France?
Yeah, in this town of Merville, we were able to bring this nice couple some pleasures that they didn't have, you know, like chocolate or sugar or, you know, things that were in short supply for them. And they were a very, very nice couple. Hmm. And one night we went out to a P-47 base, which we were told was about 6 miles from the front line, to pick up a B-17, and we never got it off because of a malfunction of something in the tail wheel. We were afraid to take it off both at the time of takeoff and landing for fear we wouldn't have any control over the plane, and they didn't have the part right then to repair that tail wheel. So I remember I think it was about the last time we went to Antwerp. Now, Antwerp was a target city. They were sending V-1 and V-2 bombs in there. And I remember we had been told that keep it in mind that I still haven't been back to combat yet. I was still spooked. And we were billeted in a four-story hotel, which was one of the higher buildings in town. I don't think there were an awful lot of buildings much higher than that. But we had been told that the Germans were throwing these V-1 bombs, which are the buzz bombs that approach with a lot of noise and rumble. But we were also told that there was a black African-American outfit on the outskirts of towns who was real good at shooting these things down. I don't know who they were, where they came from, and why they were black, but they apparently were very good at it. But we, during the evening, we had to spend the night in this hotel, and then we were going to fly a B-17 out of there the next day. And I remember we went to a nightclub, or a restaurant nightclub probably, called the Underground. And we went there because it was underground, and with these bombs falling all over the city, we thought that was a pretty good choice. But we went back to the hotel, and I remember going to bed hoping I wouldn't wake up until morning, so I wouldn't have to hear these bombs or know what was going on. But sure as a dickens, someplace around 4 o'clock in the morning, I woke up to a sound of a buzz bomb just getting louder and louder and louder, and it got to the point where it was just as loud as it could possibly get, I thought, and it cut out. And then it starts to whistle as it comes down. I thought, ooh, it's coming through the ceiling. So anyway, I couldn't get back. It landed probably a quarter mile away, I suppose, with a loud bang. But I went down to the lobby of the hotel because I couldn't get back to sleep again. And there's a little teeny little hotel, and there was a guy sitting behind the desk looking as if he was studying. I think he was probably going to college and doing his homework. But he didn't pay any attention to these bombs that were dropping all night. God, the door would pop open from the concussion of something that landed a half mile away or a block away or whatever it would be. He didn't pay any attention at all. And I'm sitting there totally nervous. And we had a real interesting flight back to, I think that was the last one we flew, but we flew back from Antwerp to Merville, France again, which would be just about south. But it had snowed down toward Merville, southern Belgium and northern France, and everything was white. It just seemed like all of our landmarks were gone. We didn't have a navigator with us, just this three-man crew, and we had to do our own visual reference navigating. It was kind of fun trying to pick out these places, and you kind of wondered whether you ever find the right one, because everything was white, you know. It didn't have that same, the cities didn't stand out that same way. And I thought that was an interesting reaction, a little boy reaction, I suppose, to common situation. But then I went back to the airbase, and they put together a crew, which we later called the Bastard Crew. Two guys from this crew, one guy from here, three or four guys from someplace else. But went back to war.
Mm. So how many missions did you fly with that crew?
14. And there's some interesting things there too. From my own personal standpoint, the third mission was kind of a milk run. The fourth mission was kind of a milk run. But the fifth one, they were going to send us back to Hamburg. So here I was, back in my nervous mode again. And oh man, I was scared. And I had a pilot this time by the name of Mel Myers, and who was another guy, a real gutsy guy. He's great. Great pilot, great crew leader. And I was really, I was so scared that day that I asked him if he would. I have told you that I was pretty good at flying formation from the right seat on the left wing of another airplane, and so usually I would fly down the bomb run because I could hold her in there pretty good. And I asked him to do this that day because I was just scared to death. Going back to this Hamburg where my crew had been shot down, I had this little private feeling about that, but of course that was easy mission too. And one thing I remember about that too is we came out, we were flying over the target northbound, we came out over the North Sea, coming out of Germany over the North Sea and down the Frisian Islands, and somewhere along there we got a burst of flak or two from someplace on the Frisian Islands which border that coast of Germany for a while, for a distance. But I remember that Mel motioned to me to turn on the, I was on the intercom, you know, telling the crew what to do or whatever, and he was listening to the outside communication, but he was fooling around with his radio and he picked up the BBC, British Broadcasting Corporation, and they were giving a broadcast about the mission that we had just flown to Hamburg. And God, that was exciting, you know, to turn on the radio and hear right then. I mean, in those days of lagging communication and everything. And
you hadn't even landed yet.
Yeah, we were nowhere near home yet.
A little bit of celebrity never hurt.
Yeah, right.
Were there, you know, in those 14 missions, you've already described some, were there some memorable
standouts? Yes. I have two in mind. Number one was not a close call or anything, but we went shortly after that Hamburg mission, we went to Oranienburg, which is about 10 or 12 miles, I think, north of Berlin. A long mission, but not, it wasn't, we weren't going to Berlin, so it wasn't a necessarily dangerous one, except for the length of it. But the thing I remember about that mission was that I, now, had a little bit of bravery in me, or whatever the heck it took. I was able to handle myself a lot better, and from then on it was that way. But the most memorable mission after that was to Nuremberg, and it was getting into April, I think, and it was really toward the tail end of the war. And Nuremberg's, I'm going to put the fear of God into you, I suppose, because it was a sizable city and probably was going to be defended pretty well. But the interesting part of the mission was that as we came out of England, the front out there, the clouds were elevating as we went east, and the clouds got higher as we went east, and we normally would fly in over a target around 27 to 29,000 feet, and on this occasion we had to, the lower guys of our squadrons were getting caught, or you know, getting into the fringes of these clouds, and they had to, the leaders had to take us up higher than we ever got before, or that I ever heard of before. And we actually got up to, as I recall, about 30,100 feet or something, or maybe 200 feet. And still the low guys were having a little trouble with the clouds down, you know, be under where I was. But
how cold is it up at that altitude?
Well, I don't know. I can't remember the cold. I know that it was awfully cold, and I think that probably 60 below or something like that at an altitude of 30,000, I would think. But it didn't make any difference to me that it was 60 or 40, you know. And I don't remember what kind of protection we had. Of course, I think in the cockpit it was probably warmed a little more by the engines, but I don't remember all the heavy gear that you usually have. I have the picture of the poor guys in the end of the airplane, in front of the airplane, and down below the airplane, just bundled up in all kinds of of fur-lined clothing, but I don't remember that so much. But anyway,
the formation's going higher.
Yeah, and there are clouds, and the one thought is that, of course, the target isn't going to be too bad because there are going to be clouds down there, and they can't see us, and we can't see them. We do the best we can to drop our bombs by radar or whatever system that there is, but they would have the same problem of seeing us, so it's going to be a little easier. But as we got to the target, the clouds just disappeared, and I know maybe 25 or 50 miles open circle. It was just absolutely clear as a bell. And man, they got that stuff real close. Our plane was bouncing around a little bit, but the interesting part from my own personal standpoint was that Mel asked me to handle the plane coming in over the target, which I thought I did pretty well. They were getting near, a lot of those guys on our crew were getting near the end of their missions. 35 was required then, and I was only on number 12 or 13, something like that. I had a long way to go. I think they were getting nervous. Maybe I can get out of this after all, they're thinking. And they're getting nervous like way back at the beginning of the tour of missions, but I was the...
On the countdown, yeah.
Yeah.
Was there some sense, though, like on your last mission that the war was coming to an end? It was just a question of when and how soon?
I don't remember having that feeling. I remember being rather surprised that it was all over when it was over. I'm sure we all had the idea that we were coming to the end, but I don't remember feeling any relief or that we were suddenly going to be done. No, I was prepared to go all the way. But I was getting pretty good at it, so.
Was it, go ahead.
I had one thing I wanted to tell you about. We have a hero in our group by the name of Buck Dunn. I don't know whether you've ever heard of that. Well, Buck was on our bastard crew. Buck had been through, I don't know how many tours. During the missions that we flew with him, and I have always said that it was my last 14 missions, but apparently he didn't come on there until maybe a couple of missions, maybe only 12 missions I flew with him, but he had signed up two or three times to go for another tour, and everybody was afraid to fly with him because his number had to come up. The old saying in those days was, your number had to come up. We were afraid, everybody was afraid that his number was going to come up and everybody go down with him, but it never happened. During the time that he was flying with us, he completed his 100th mission, and when we got to the ground after that mission, the press was there. Stars and Stripes, I think, and I would think Yank Magazine, well, whoever would be the press, they were there to meet us and took pictures and interviewed Mel and Buck, and it was kind of an exciting little sideline.
What kind of guy was, I mean, you know, you tend to think, what kind of a guy?
I can tell you a lot missions? About this guy.
I mean, just generally, what
I was think he got through to 104 and before the war ended. I didn't know him too well, of course, because I was an officer. We were billeted, you know, barracked in different places from the enlisted men, but I had a lot of contact with him on the airplane and in and around the airplane. And he had been reputed to be a pretty good drinker, and he had skirmishes that way, and he was big, burly fellow. We went out on a mission. He was going to be, for one time only, I think, was going to be our engineer. He was going to be in the turret right behind the pilot and the co-pilot. And for a big, burly guy like that, that was kind of confinement. He didn't have enough operating room, but one of the jobs that the co-pilot had was to do an oxygen check. As I recall, every 20 minutes the co-pilot would ask the crew to respond by number or position, just to let us know that he was alive, that they were alive back there. So when it got to his number, which is probably 5, why, no answer. God, I turned around, he's on the floor kicking. You know, he had disconnected himself from his oxygen with this twirling turret, and he was passing out. So I let Mel know that, of course, and Mel had our navigator, Bill Howe, come up with an oxygen bottle, but he couldn't apply the oxygen bottle because Buck was so big, and Bill Howe couldn't move him, and so I don't remember why Mel had such access to the guy, but he told me to get out of formation and dive this plane down as fast as I could go and go back to the base. And he got out of his chair, out of his seat, and he went down to Mel, Buck on the floor, took off his oxygen mask and put it on Buck's face. Now, I don't know why Bill couldn't have done the same thing, but anyway, there was some logistical reason why he couldn't do that. He sure tried. And so Mel passed out eventually from the lack of oxygen, and Buck was already out, but he now had oxygen. And I took the thing down, redlining it all the way as fast as we could go. And of course, the worst part of this was that we were then out in the skies over Germany with no protection and the distinct possibility that fighters could jump us and just make mincemeat out of us, but we never saw anything. And pretty soon, Mel revived, and Buck revived, and we went home. Yeah. Dropped the bombs in the ocean, I guess. I don't remember that part either. Uh-huh. Kind of exciting. Not too long after that, a couple of missions later, they gave Mel the DFC for that. A couple of missions later, Mel got kind of playful one day, and he said, you know, I've been a co-pilot. I want to take this airplane off from the right seat. So he put me in the left seat. I'd never had but just a few minutes of experience in the left seat, and he took the plane off from the right seat, and he got all screwed up. It was a very windy afternoon with crosswinds, and it was very difficult to control the airplane going down the runway, and he got it all messed up and started swerving back and forth across the runway, and finally he got to the point where he had to put on the full power in order to get us off the runway. And the direction he was heading was right towards some tall trees, straight standing trees, I forget what kind they were, but down nestled at the base of these trees was the bomb dump. And we were headed across the grass, not on the runway, right toward this stand of trees with all this ammunition down at the bottom. And it didn't look like we were going to make it over there, but he just, plain heroism, he got us up over there just by a branch, you know, just barely cleared it. So after everything had calmed down, Buck comes on, but by this time Buck was flying in the nose. He was our toggleer. He came on the intercom and he says, a heck of a guy you are. You saved my life one day and try to kill me the next. Because he was up there in the front, looking at the trees coming right at him, boy. Anyway, that was Buck Dunn.
Did you stop at 14 missions because the war ended?
16.
16.
Sorry. Well, yeah, I had a kind of nice ending too, because they had decided that it was time for us to have our flak leave. Halfway through the tour, they would send each of the crews on a what they call a flak leave, send it to a rest home for 10 days or something really nice, but there was no availability in the rest or the flak homes, flak houses as we called them at that time, so they just sent us, just told us to go where we wanted to go. So Bill Howe and I went up to Scotland and did a little touring of towns up there. Huh. The war ended during that. No, that's not true. They stopped flying missions during that period of time. Cut it down. I think the last one was about April 20th. Guessing.
Something like that.
The war ended on May 8th.
Do you remember what the sense was when it had dawned on you that this is over, you're going home?
Yes, I remember very well that it didn't make any difference to me because I was going to have to go fight in the Pacific War. Peace, that peace was, of course, very exciting, but it wasn't very significant to me because I knew I was going to go on and do some more in the other direction. Never developed, however. And I remember also that on the day that the peace was declared, they would not allow us off of the base to go celebrate with the English people. And they would not allow us to go to the officers' club. They closed the bar. Total sobriety. Yeah. And all the guys, the lucky guys, that were out on pass on the day the war ended, all they had to do was to report to the paymaster's office in London or wherever they were and pick up some cash and keep going. Not us. What we did was we went down to the airplane and shot very pistols, our flare pistols. They had fireworks anyway, that was what we had. By the time they let us off the base, the country was so crippled and tired from celebrating that there was nobody to celebrate with.
Kind of describe, I don't know, and give me a synopsis of you know, getting back to the States that evidently didn't develop. You went into the Pacific. You were not going to go to the Pacific at some point. Mm-hmm. What kind of take us through? Tell us the end of the story.
The end of the story to me, of course, was that I was given a crew of my own after we stopped flying missions. You know, there's a lot more to say. Yeah. To me, the most touching experience of my life was flying food to the Dutch. You probably heard that one before.
Well, tell us about what was your experience with that?
I am of the impression that we went in on the first day, and we flew formation, and my recollection is we had the full crew with us, too, and I don't know why, because we had a bomb bay full of food rather than bombs, but we had been told that the higher-ups had arranged some sort of a truce arrangement with the Germans that we were, the Germans still occupied Holland, but the Dutch were starving terribly. And I think this was even before the 1st of May, too. But they told us that they couldn't assure us that we weren't going to get shot at, so we were, you know, duly scared and feeling pretty cautious about it, but they flew us in over the coast in formation, I'd say about 1,000 feet, and I can remember looking down and seeing emplacements in the sand dunes with German soldiers there. You're getting pretty close at 1,000 feet. And we flew in, I guess Mel must have been doing most of the flying, because I can remember these visions that I saw down there. I remember seeing an older man poling a boat down a canal on a, you know, above a dike, and he stopped his operation and waved his pole at us. And then I remember seeing a little young lady riding a bicycle down a canal road, and she took off her, you know, stopped her bike, took off her kerchief and waved at us. And I remember going over a factory where the workers were all out in the factory yard and waving at us. And the one that really got to me was the little schoolyard we went over, and all the little students were there with a bunch of tall teachers sticking out of this mass of students, and they were all waving at us. And of course, on our crew, we were all wondering what Buck was going to say when we dropped the food. You know, he'd been saying bombs away for 10 or 12, 13 missions, and so he came on when we dropped the food, and he says, groceries away. That was another Buck done.
It must have been satisfying to really accomplish something that was benefit. I mean, let's face it, dropping bombs is destructive. There's a purpose. It has to be done. But this was a constructive humanitarian thing.
Yeah, I tear up over that one. And I remember one day telling my sister about it years later, and I just bawled. But I had been given my own crew, and then we did another mercy kind of mission after that, and I was the first pilot, and they sent us, this is a total new bunch of guys that I'd never heard of before, and we went over to Linz, Austria to pick up French people who had been made prisoners, labor prisoners of war, and we arrived at the Linz airport, I guess, you know, some base of some kind. And there were thousands and thousands and thousands of people standing or sitting on the land around the airport. And all of us, our planes coming in, we flew over one by one and not in formation, but I did two of those food missions, by the way. But I remember the feeling that I had of landing on that runway and then taxiing around to pick up my load of guys, and I've never felt so important in my entire life, because I had this captive audience of 25,000 people waiting for me to come to pick some of them up. I thought that I felt pretty important for a 20-year-old guy. And then we had a real interesting trip home. We had I was again the pilot of the crew, and we had a crew of nine, and we had 11 ground support people that we had to take home. We're happy to take home with us, with all of our own belongings. You know, it didn't make very heavy load, but We're waiting day after day after day for to get the word, when are we going to fly? We're getting kind of excited to get back to the U.S. by this time, but finally the day came and they flew back over to Wales. I don't know why, 2 hours or an hour and a half or something like that, we landed and spent the night in Wales, and the next morning we got up ready to go on the mission. We were going to fly to the Azores. And we went out just as if we were on a mission, nose to tail, 30 seconds, off you go. The weather was coming down on us, and I have been told that we were the last crew off. They shut it down after me, and as soon as I, from my experience, as soon as I put the nose of the airplane in the air, I was blanked out with the fog, with the clouds, and made an immediate shift from visual reference to instruments, which was kind of tricky in itself, but especially being so close to the ground. But we went up to 10,000 feet before we came out. This was a little different from the usual 10,000, because normally we would be circling up to go on a mission and meet up at 17,000 feet, going around in circles. This is you're going straight, you're going your course toward the Azores. And when we got to the top, of course, we had no reference to the ocean or any land. There was just nothing down there except clouds for a while. When we leveled off, I forget what altitude we flew at, but at 10,000 feet, you're getting pretty near the, you're at the max as far as supposed to fly with oxygen, but we didn't have any oxygen for our passengers, of course. But anyway, we had nothing but the sun to for the navigator to shoot at and make his calculations on, so he did that. Eventually we ran out of clouds and there was ocean to refer to, and what we were supposed to do is to make a slight change in direction about the halfway point and fly over a British destroyer, which was anchored out there waiting for us to use him as a reference point. But anyway, after a little while, my navigator took a shot or two at the sun and he said, I want you to make a 1 degree change to the left. I thought that was pretty sensible. So we made a 1 degree change in our heading to the left, and probably on automatic pilot up there. A little while later, he says, now I want you to make a 35 degree turn to the right. And I thought, man, you're out of your tree. I'm not going to make any 35 degree turn to the right. You know, this was just something that you didn't do. If you did that, you're lost. And that's a sign of being lost. But anyway, he quickly said, and in 1 minute you should be over the destroyer. And boy, we were right on.
Did you make that turn, 35 degrees?
Yep. Yeah. We went right over the destroyer and then on to the Azores. And then from there we spent the night, went over to Gander Lake and down into Winter Locks, Connecticut on another day. Kissed goodbye to the airplane, and they haven't flown a B-17 since. The war ended when I was on a 30-day leave, and I was on my way back to Sioux Falls, South Dakota, to regroup and learn B-29s. Huh. It never happened.
Had you had a girlfriend or somebody? I mean, did you know somebody that? Did you get married after the war and that kind of thing?
Yeah, well after the war.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
I did have a girlfriend, but I really wasn't very convinced,
yeah.
I guess, and acted accordingly.
Had you been able to stay in touch with your family during the war, V-mail, that kind of stuff? Or?
You know, I think what happened is that while I was overseas, I probably gave away too many war secrets in my letters, and I don't think they ever got home. I'm not sure. But many, many, many letters that I had sent during the training year were sent home and saved for me, and I have them.
You described this young kid from Massachusetts, California, that went through the B-17 training, all that young age, it's an adventure. Went over to wartime Europe, went through all of the experiences you've just described. How was the man who came back different than the kid who left?
According to me, not different at all. According to my mother, quite different. I don't remember in what way, but I guess, I don't know. Probably I needed to shave a little more often. And I don't know.
Well, do you think you came back more self-confident?
Probably a little, yeah. I knew I had something to grasp, you know, something to recall and be proud of. Mm. But I don't, and I've never been a very confident individual, even to this day. I came home with a great respect for the British people.
How is that? Why?
Oh, I just saw what they were going through and how they received us, and just admirable.
You know, at the age you are now and with all the life experience you've got under your belt, when you look back at that 20-year-old, what's your sense of it? What do you think about?
That is pronounced for me when I step in, no, I crawl, I struggle into the pilot seat of this B-17 out here. How did I ever do this? I don't know.
Well, did I cover it all?
I guess I covered it all, didn't I? My apologies.